Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pedagogy of the Oppressed, 50th Anniversary Edition, by Paulo Freire. Translated by Myra Bergman-Ramos. Introduction by Donaldo Macedo. Afterword by Ira Shor. Narrated by Dennis Kleinman. Introduction to the 50th Anniversary Edition. Donaldo Macedo, University of Massachusetts, Boston, USA. A day after New York City came up with a $1,000 bagel, a local restaurateur unveiled a $27,000 chocolate sundae, setting a Guinness World Record for the most expensive dessert. Reuters Business News, November 7, 2007. It is indeed an honor to write the introduction to Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed, a book that is unquestionably a classic as it has throughout this last half century, become increasingly more relevant as the 21st century ushers the world into a very dark new age. Leading intellectuals such as Noam Chomsky, Zygmunt Bauman, Henri Giraud, Arundhati Roy, Amy Goodman, Thomas Piketty, among others, have wisely and incessantly alerted people around the world of the dire consequences, that is, denial of climate change, obscene economic inequality, potential nuclear catastrophe of the far-right power hegemony that, if left unchecked, may potentially result in the end of humanity as we know it. Thus, not only must an alternative political course be taken, but central to its agenda must also be the development of people's critical awareness of how they are in the world and with the world, a posture which Freire insisted upon and which informed his brilliant and insightful ideals in Pedagogy of the Oppressed. That is to say, Freire's major goal in Pedagogy of the Oppressed was not to propose an innovative methodology, which would be antithetical to his critique of formulaic models of education, but to launch the development of an emancipatory pedagogical process that invites and challenges students through critical literacies to learn how to negotiate the world in which they find themselves in a thoughtful and critically reflective manner, so as to expose and engage the tensions and contradictions inherent in the ongoing relations between the oppressor and the oppressed. Thus, the central goal of Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed is to awaken in the oppressed the knowledge, creativity, and constant critical reflective capacities necessary to unveil, demystify, and understand the power relations responsible for their oppressed marginalization, and through this recognition, begin a project of liberation through praxis which, invariably, requires consistent, never-ending critical reflection and action. Currently, while more and more educators are embracing Freire, many of them, including some liberal and progressives, allow their critical discourse to be betrayed by a lack of coherence between their denouncement of oppressive conditions and their accommodation to dominant structures that created these oppressive structures in the first place, a point to which I will return later. Approximately a month or so before Paulo Freire's untimely death on May 2, 1997, he and I were walking on New York's Fifth Avenue, discussing the obvious contradictions of New York City's opulence that makes it possible for people to flaunt their wealth, for instance, paying $27,000 for a chocolate sundae in luxurious restaurants amid thousands and thousands of homeless people, including families with children who sleep in cars, under bridges, and in overcrowded shelters. The unpacking of these contradictions was to be the major goal of a course that Freire and I were contracted to co-teach at the Harvard Graduate School of Education in fall 1997. We'd agreed that we would invite students into a critical dialogue about bodies of knowledges not usually emphasized in the academy, such as ethics, the substantivity of democracy beyond the four-year of carnivalesque voting cycle, as we have recently witnessed with Donald Trump's successful campaign for the presidency, and a rigorous study of ideology and its role of reading the word and the world. During our walk along Fifth Avenue, Freire would frequently ask me if we could stop, so he could more emphatically make his points and share his concerns regarding the destructive and oppressive forces of neoliberalism in developed and developing countries. Frequently, we would lean against the wall of imposing buildings to avoid the usual frantic torrent of hurried people who, in a dizzying way, wanted to forge ahead of the other pedestrians, those perhaps who, on occasion, may have slowed down a bit to satisfy their consumerist curiosity at the unending and seductive store window displays of fashion and the latest technological gadgets, a hallmark of an obsessively consumerist society, a society where money is the measure of all things and profit the primary goal. For the oppressors, what is worthwhile is to have more, always more, even at the cost of the oppressed having less or having nothing. For them, to be is to have. Page 58. In retrospect, I now realize that Freire's frequent requests to stop had more to do with the fatigue he was experiencing due to his heart condition, an ailment which he kept very much to himself and about which he seldom complained. While Freire always remained true to his view of history as possibility and maintained an unflinching hope that a less discriminatory, more just, less dehumanizing, and more humane world is possible, he was always critical of the libertarian propaganda that merely implant in the oppressed a belief in freedom, thus thinking to win their trust. Accordingly, Freire believed that the correct method lies in dialogue, a process that unveils the conviction of the oppressed that they must fight for their liberation, which is not a gift bestowed by the revolutionary leadership, but the result of their own conscientizazao. During this long and engaging walk, Freire shared with me, semi-joking, that the ruling class will never send us to Copacabana for a vacation. If we want to go to Copacabana, we have to fight for it. In this last long walk and dialogue with Freire, he would often reveal his frustration that, at times, bordered on just ire, as he would often say, relative to the accommodation of some turncoat progressives to the neoliberal theology. Such was the case of his friend, the former president of Brazil, Fernando Henriquez, who, like Freire, had been exiled to Chile by Brazil's brutal neo-Nazi military dictatorship that killed and tortured thousands of Brazilians. In fact, Brazil's experimentation with neoliberalism under the government of Fernando Henriquez exacerbated already cruel conditions and sentenced millions of Brazilians to hunger, human misery, and despair, which in turn contributed to the widening of the economic and educational inequality gap while unleashing more systemic government corruption. Sadly, most socialist governments in the Western world of that time betrayed their commitment to social justice, equality, and equity by veering toward a neoliberal market-crazed ideology, which not only crushed the hope of people who aspired for a better world, but also brought down the governments by enabling obscene corruption, as was the case in Portugal, Spain, and Greece. In the latter country, the Socialist Party, led by Prime Minister George Papandreou, allowed corruption to reach epidemic proportions to the point where, for example, the PASOK would buy votes by offering free airfare tickets to Greek citizens living in the United States who were willing to fly to Greece with the promise of voting for the socialists. Such acts smack of the tactics that Western democracies routinely criticize as the fraudulent election rigging they say plague those countries pejoratively termed Third World Banana Republics. To a degree, socialist governments in multiple continents fell from power due to obscene scandals of corruption which, in general, gave rise to center-right and far-right governments. Greece is an exception where the radical left Syriza party won the election that have now been elected by dissatisfied and disenfranchised voters, voters who became the victims of the austerity measures imposed by neoliberal policies. Freire also did not hesitate to demonstrate his just ire by denouncing the critical posture of many facile liberals and some so-called critical educators who often find refuge in the academy by hiding their addiction to obscene consumerism while at the same time attacking in their written critical discourses the market theology of neoliberalism. Too often, these facile liberal and so-called critical educators' tastes and ways of being in the world and with the world remain, according to Freire, wedded to the very neoliberal market solutions that they denounce at the level of written critical discourse. In their day-to-day practices, these facile liberals and so-called critical educators often betray the action required by praxis by fossilizing their purported political project into an obscure discursive criticality that begs to move beyond the always postponed arrival of action. That is, action designed to transform the current perniciousness of the neoliberal godification of the market into new democratic structures that lead to equity, equality, and authentic democratic practices. In other words, many facile liberals and so-called critical educators boast of their leftist credentials by wearing their proclaimed Marxism on their sleeve, usually only expressed in written discourse or in the safety of the academy, and sometimes feel the urge to further boast that, for example, their radicalism is beyond Marx's proposals to the degree that they are authentically more Maoist in their political orientation, a posture they believe to be even more radical. As a consequence, leftist labels in the academy become an appropriated, exoticized political and cultural currency, where to be a Marxist in residence in the ivory tower bestows status, but is little more than a chic brand. In reality, the epitome of consumerism sustained by transactions occurring in a merely symbolic register of names and labels that are otherwise vacuous in substance. In essence, the academic branding of Marxist by some critical educators turns ethical and political action into a spectacle and leftist viewpoints into de facto commodities. As commodities, these self-ascribed radical positions and labels are emptied out of their progressive content to the extent that they are decoupled from principled action, a decoupling that remains fundamental in the reproduction of the market theology of neoliberalism, where collective social engagement based on critical thinking is discouraged and zealous cutthroat competition is rewarded. The insidious process of decoupling critical discourse and action legitimizes not walking the talk. It affords the proclaimed Marxist in residence the opportunity, for instance, to claim to be anti-racist while turning anti-racism into a lifeless cliché that does not provide pedagogical spaces to critique white supremacist ideologies. In this process, their progressive stances are often co-opted, mobilized only to the degree that they denounce racism at the level of written critical discourse, all the while reaping privileges from the cemented institutional racism which they, willfully, refuse to acknowledge and engage in action to dismantle. Hence, these Marxists in residence also ignore the political and systemic impact of racism that was amply witnessed in the 2016 U.S. presidential campaign, and which became more frightening with each calculated pronouncement by Donald Trump used to ignite white rage against people rather than against the state for conditions caused, in large part, by the neoliberal policies that the enraged white working class ironically embrace. The election of Trump as president has, in essence, unveiled the lie behind the post-race slogan which proclaimed that racism is over, a slogan that took shape with the election of Barack Obama, the first black president. Furthermore, the very failure to acknowledge the ravages of racism while enlarging ghettos, normalizing the school-to-prison pipeline made up mostly of blacks and Latinos, and expanding human misery as a byproduct of racism constitutes in itself a racist act. It is racism when these proclaimed Marxists and Maoists in residence proselytize against racism as an abstract idea and resist the intellectual and societal pressure to translate this abstract idea at the level of written critical discourse into action that would racially democratize society and its institutions. How racially democratic are, for example, the universities, when most departments remain practically all white, lest for token professors of color and a minuscule number of non-white students? For instance, does race play a role in the almost non-existence of African Americans in classics departments, both at the faculty and student levels, or is it the case that African Americans are genetically wired to have no vocation toward the study of classics and are, consequently, averse to classical studies? More pernicious yet is when these self-proclaimed leftists in residence engage in the social construction of not seeing the ingrained racism in their statements and in their behavior. For example, Take the case of a proclamation made by a liberal white professor working in an urban university that prides itself for its diversity. "We just want these black kids to learn how to learn." Such a remark not only points to a rigidly ethnocentric notion of the act of knowing, as insightfully argued by Freire in Pedagogy of the Oppressed, but it also shows that individuals making such statements remain shackled by white supremacist ideology that has inculcated them in myths and beliefs that children from certain races and cultures are innately incapable of learning until they receive the recipes taught to the poor and the oppressed by educators who often carry in their leather Gucci bags or briefcases these prepackaged lesson plans to teach, for example, African Americans what they cannot already know because they have never even had the capacity to acquire knowledge until then. The very survival of the cruel conditions in which these non-white children have been condemned to live demonstrates that they know very well how to learn in order to stay alive in circumstances of savages' inequalities, as poignantly described by Jonathan Cazole in several of his books. Would the daughters and sons of these Marxist-in-residence educators survive the ravages of such entrenched social inequalities and remain unscathed while excelling in the required high-stakes testing? Probably not. Hence, the very survival from the most horrendous forms of racism, segregation, gender, and class discrimination not only point to a high level of intelligence of children who are ghettoized, but would add credence to Howard Gardner's notion of multiple intelligence beyond the Western-centric notions of intelligence. The just ire that Freire demonstrated in his last dialogue with me when he denounced some critical educators who inhabit silk underwear was in turn channeled by him as a creative force toward the end of his life, both in his writings, as exemplified by his last book, Pedagogy of Freedom, and in his many later dialogues and lectures throughout the world. Freire correctly opposed the pseudo-critical educator, whose political project of social justice is betrayed by intellectual incoherence and a crass careerism fueled by what Freire often called the ethics of the market under neoliberalism. In other words, the intellectual incoherence of many critical educators ultimately defines and confines their political project into mere neoliberal crass careerism. However, it is important to point out that Freire's disgust with a crass careerist does not mean that he was against the pursuit of a career. There is a marked difference between having a career that is not instrumentalist and which is situated within a political project that strives for a world that, as Freire would often say, is more round, less unjust, and more democratic, and a careerist whose political project is his or her own individual advancement, marked by sophistry and obscene greed, which almost always sacrifice equity, equality, and authentic democracy. That is to say, the careerist's political project is ultimately his or her career, and to save his or her career, the crass careerist will fail to initiate or will abandon dialogue, reflection, and communication, and will fall into using slogans, communiques, monologues, and instructions. Superficial conversions to the cause of liberation carry this danger. The danger lies, for example, in the disarticulation of writing about hunger within the confines and safety of the academy and the actual experience of hunger, or in making the sloganized proclamation, "I'm a Maoist," while refusing to de-Gucci-fy and allowing oneself to remain shackled to bourgeois values that undergird much of the neoliberal project, and which deem the appropriation and accumulation of things as more important than the expansion of humanity. As Freire insightfully argued in Pedagogy of the Oppressed, the liberation of the oppressed is a liberation of women and men, not things. Accordingly, while no one liberates herself or himself by her or his own efforts alone, neither is she or he liberated by others. Liberation, a human phenomenon, cannot be achieved by semi-humans. In any attempts to treat people as semi-humans, as in the case of white supremacy and patriarchy, only dehumanizes them. A semi-human, whose only concern is things and not people, can never, nor is he or she willing to offer a form of literacy that leads to liberation and emancipation. Quite to the contrary, a semi-human who pursues the process of othering human beings so as to devalue and typecast them has already lost his or her humanity to the extent that he or she cannot see humanity in others. Accordingly, for Freire, literacy was not a means to prepare students for the world of subordinated labor or careers, but a preparation for a self-managed life. And self-management could only occur when people have fulfilled three goals of education. Self-reflection, that is, realizing the famous poetic phrase, know thyself, which is an understanding of the world in which they live, in its economic, political, and equally important, its psychological dimensions. Specifically, critical pedagogy helps the learner become aware of the forces that have hitherto ruled their lives and especially shaped their consciousness. The third goal is to help set the conditions for producing a new life, a new set of arrangements where power has been, at least in tendency, transferred to those who literally make the social world by transforming nature and themselves. Because Freire was often criticized for not critically addressing issues of race relations in Pedagogy of the Oppressed, one of his major goals in the course that we were going to co-teach at Harvard Graduate College of Education in 1997 was to expand our dialogue titled A Dialogue, Culture, Language, and Race, which has been published by Harvard Educational Review. In this dialogue, Freire, in a self-critique, explained why class oppression preoccupied him more than race relations when he wrote Pedagogy of the Oppressed, given the historical context that shaped oppression in Brazil, an oppression experienced by Freire and his family, who lost their middle-class status and had to move from the city and live in the poor lower-class area named Morro de Sauda. Freire's denunciation of oppression did not constitute a mere intellectual exercise that we often find among many facile liberals and pseudo-critical educators. His intellectual brilliance and courage in denouncing the structures of oppression were rooted in a very real and material experience, as he recounts his childhood and adolescent years living in poverty in Morro de Sauda. The experience of hunger as a child of a formerly middle-class family that had lost its economic base enabled Freire to, on the one hand, identify and develop solidarity with the children from the poor outskirts of town, and, on the other hand, to realize that in spite of the hunger that gave us solidarity, in spite of the bond that united us in our search for ways to survive, our playtime, as far as the poor children were concerned, ranked us as people from another world, who happened to fall accidentally into their world. It is the realization of such class borders that led invariably to Freire's radical rejection and denunciation of a class-based society. Although some strands of postmodernism would dismiss Freire's detailed class analysis in Pedagogy of the Oppressed, it is an enormous mistake, if not academic dishonesty, to pretend that we now live in a classless world. Although Freire understood very well that material oppression and the effect of investments that tie oppressed groups to the logic of domination cannot be grasped in all of their complexity within a singular logic of class struggle, he consistently argued that a thorough understanding of oppression must always take a detour through some form of class analysis. At the same time, a postmodern posture that over-celebrates identity politics not only leads to essentialism, but also contains within it seeds of oppression. Take, for example, the progressive Massachusetts Senator Elizabeth Warren's claim to be American Indian, even though she's many generations removed from American Indian ancestry and grew up as white and was totally removed from the oppressive life of reservations. Senator Warren's opportunistic use of the race card to make herself more attractive as a candidate for a professorial position at Harvard Law School and Harvard University's use of her employment as proof of its commitment to diversity only demonstrates how dominant institutions rely on tokenism to reinforce their exclusionary policies that do not welcome the presence of non-white groups in their institutions other than as token representatives. In reality, the opportunistic use of racial or gender cards defang the very spirit of the Civil Rights Act. It also provides segregationists and those beholden by patriarchy and white supremacy with ammunition to dismiss and criticize the anti-discriminatory laws that discourage exclusion on the base of race or gender. Until his death, Freire courageously denounced the neoliberal position that promotes the false notion of the end of history and the end of class. In contrast to the idea that society has reached the endpoint of its evolution, thus emptying history of its meaning, Freire always viewed historical awareness as an ongoing condition for human betterment, opening up the possibility of a better future when recognizing that history is time-filled with possibility and not inexorably determined, that the future is problematic and not already decided fatalistically. In like manner, Freire continued to reject any false claim to the end of class struggle. Whereas he continually revised his earlier class analysis, he never abandoned or devalued class as an important theoretical category in our search for a better comprehension of conditions of oppression. In the long dialogue we had during his last visit to New York, in fact, the last time we worked together, he restated this view that although one cannot reduce everything to class, class remains an important factor in our understanding of multiple forms of oppression. While post-structuralists may want to proclaim the end of class analysis, they still have to account for the horrendous human conditions that led, as Freire recounted, a family in northeast Brazil to scavenge for food in a landfill and take pieces of an amputated human breast with which they prepared their Sunday lunch. Even though I experienced the great good fortune of working with Paulo for 16 uninterrupted years, first translating many of his books into English and later collaborating with him on other book projects, I have read and reread The Pedagogy of the Oppressed so many times, with each rereading of this book, I gain new insights in my understanding of our current world, a world that is plagued by manufactured wars, expanding human misery, and obscene greed. Without falling into false modesty, I have always felt I understood Freire's leading ideas, the subtleties and the nuances that characterize the pedagogy of the oppressed. But I did not fully capture the layered complexity of Freire's philosophy until I visited Moro da Saudade, an impoverished community on the outskirts of Recife in northeast Brazil. As mentioned earlier, Freire and his family had moved there after the great economic crash of the 1930s that unceremoniously yanked the middle-class rug from under Freire's family. No longer able to afford housing in Recife as the economic situation worsened, Freire's family moved to a modest house in Moro da Saudade, where Paulo, his siblings, his parents, and other close family members took refuge. I immediately began to see new dimensions and the raison d'être of Pedagogy of the Oppressed. As I entered the modest house, its dark, small rooms without an indoor bathroom and with non-existing ceilings, I began to put into perspective the traumas that must have overwhelmed Freire as he came face to face with a new form of schooling called life. Life created and sustained by a cruel system that uncaringly relegated millions and millions of Brazilians to half-citizenry and sub-humanity. I also took a short walk along a shrinking river where Freire and his friends used to take baths alongside the neighborhood woman who would religiously wash clothes on a daily basis. The sun was the only towel available to Freire to dry his skin. Freire learned quickly that a psychological class wall enveloped his new reality as he began to get acquainted with his new friends and neighbors. Their humanity enabled him to empathize with his aunt Natasia's preoccupation with keeping their poverty hidden and to understand why the family would not let go of Lourdes's German piano or his father's neckties, even when his father was doing manual chores in the workshop. But Freire soon learned that his family's clinging to middle-class markers and mores did little to alleviate their pain, a pain almost always treated with disrespectful language, as his mother, who had been denied groceries on credit since the family was never able to pay, would leave the shop to look for another one, where new offences were almost always added to these already suffered. In an effort to protect his mother from such daily blows to her dignity, Freire would often wander into the backyards of neighbours to steal chickens that would frequently be that day's only family meal, since by then all of the town's merchants had refused to grant his family credit. To protect his family's middle-class sensitivities, Freire would euphemize his backyard thefts as incursions into a neighbor's yard. Freire's mother was a Christian Catholic who no doubt viewed such incursions as violations of her moral principles, but she must have realized that her alternatives were either to reproach Freire severely and make him return the still-warm chicken to their neighbors, or to prepare the fowl as a special dinner. Her common sense prevailed. Still silent, she took that chicken, walked across the patio, entered the kitchen, and lost herself in doing a job she had not done in a long time. Freire's mother knew that stealing a neighbor's chicken was morally wrong and constituted a crime, but she also knew that there was an a priori crime committed by society, the manufacturing of hunger. As Freire recounted, the problem of hunger created by social inequality was real and concrete hunger that had no specific date of departure. On the contrary, our hunger was the type that arrives unannounced and unauthorized, making itself at home without end in sight. A hunger that, if it was not softened as ours was, would take over our bodies, molding them into angular shapes. Legs, arms, and fingers become skinny. Eye sockets become deeper, making the eyes almost disappear. Many of our classmates experienced this hunger, and today it continues to afflict millions of Brazilians who die of its violence every year. It is against this form of violence that Freire angrily and compassionately wrote Pedagogy of the Oppressed. In fact, I honestly believe that Pedagogy of the Oppressed would not have been written without Freire's class dislocation and the experience of hunger. The reading and rereading of Freire's insights after I visited his humble home in Moro de Saude, both his denunciation of dehumanizing conditions and his announcement that change is difficult but possible, unleashed in me a complex of emotions wrought with a reconfirmation of a tremendous loss in his death, a loss infused with anguish, doubt, expectation, and sadness. At the same time, with each new publication of Freire's unpublished work and publications about his theories regarding the liberation of women and men, we can celebrate in joy Freire's return, as he over and over again energizes and challenges us to imagine a world that is less cruel, more just, and more democratic. However, as Freire so energetically insisted in his writings, the announcement of a more just and humane world must always be preceded by the denunciation of the dominant forces that generate, inform, and shape discrimination, human misery, and dehumanization. Hence, the denunciation of oppressive societal forces cannot be done through mere instructional methodologies that anesthetize and domesticate the mind, through banal information transmission that Freire termed as banking education. Yet Freire's condemnation of mere methods continues to be misappropriated and distorted. There is deep irony in some of academics' efforts to interrogate whether Freire's methods work and to apologetically provide examples of Freirean schools that do work, as Howard Gardner did in a panel discussion on Freire with Noam Chomsky and Bruno de la Cise, which took place at Harvard in May 2013 as part of an Ask With forum, thus vulgarizing Freire's intellectual contributions and his major theories. To reduce Freire's leading theoretical and philosophical ideas to a method in such an overt manner is to demonstrate that Gardner's touted theory of multiple intelligence is susceptible to narrow-mindedness, particularly when Freire's theories are dismissed as irrelevant, a dismissal clearly shaped and controlled by ideology. Therefore, the demand posed by Gardner to Noam Chomsky, Bruno de la Cise, and Forum's audience to provide concrete examples which demonstrate that Freire's method itself works hides more than it elucidates. The real question regarding Freire's ideas and theories in Pedagogy of the Oppressed is whether it is correct to view Freire's literacy proposals as mere instructional methods, as Noam Chomsky responded to Gardner during the forum. According to Chomsky, Freire used literacy as a means to consciousness raising. Simply put, Chomsky was urging educators in general and critical educators in particular to move beyond the fetishization of methods that so paralyzes thinking, innovation, and creativity among North American educators, a phenomenon insightfully analyzed by Lilia I. Bartolome in her classic article, Beyond the Methods Fetish, Towards a Humanizing Pedagogy, published by the Harvard Educational Review. Consequently, Freire has to be viewed and understood beyond his literacy instructional methods, by critically apprehending his notion of conscientization, a concept that is often misunderstood even by critical educators who claim to be Freirean and conveniently dismissed by educators whose interest is to appropriate Freire's dialogical method disarticulated from Freire's major theoretical goal, thus reducing him to a mere instructional methodologist. In addition to methods fetish of many educators, one of the challenges of defining Freire's original concept, conscientização, lies in the difficulty of pronouncing a Portuguese word. Portuguese speakers also experienced varied difficulty pronouncing it, and also in the fact that most definitions of this insightful concept rarely do justice to what Freire had in mind. Freire always insisted that before we even attempt to define conscientização, we need to adhere to the essence of this concept and ask, what definition, against what, for whom, and against whom? If we begin to answer these questions, we soon realize that, even for many followers of Freire's thinking, conscientização presents a certain difficulty beyond the hurdles of its correct pronunciation, being a term that Freire, at least initially, refused to have translated into English by simply stating, I refuse. Why not accept this term? I do not have to accept stress, but I have. Why do you not accept conscientização? Freire eventually agreed to have his term translated into the approximate English translation, conscientization. For Freire, the demystification of conscientization would necessarily have to include the reclaiming of the oppressed's own words as a process of coming to voice, which he viewed as the fundamental theme of the Third World, implying a difficult but not impossible task for its people, which is the conquest of its right to voice, of the right to pronounce its word. It is this right that the oppressed need to reclaim in order to speak their word, the right to be themselves, to assume direction of their destiny. It is this right that the dominant forces go to great lengths to suffocate, seeking to sequester the words of the oppressed, words that unveil the mechanism of oppression and are distorted or repressed, as Henri Giraud suggests in a society that revels in bouts of historical and social amnesia, in which it is much easier for the language of politics and community to be stolen and deployed like a weapon, so as to empty words such as democracy, freedom, justice, and the social state of any viable meaning. The sequestration of language by dominant forces of oppression and even by liberal educators who proselytize about empowering minorities and giving them voice when they themselves represent the majority is evident in the overuse and abuse of euphemisms in academic discourses and mainstream media. Euphemism is a form of language that not only mystifies and distorts reality, it is also a much-used technique by dominant forces, the media, political pundits, the educated class, to distract attention from the real issues that ail society, such as the obscene widening of the income gap between the rich and the poor, the pernicious shrinking of the middle class, and the generalized alienation of the dispossessed. The suppression or distortion of language is a tactic that, according to Arundhati Roy, also appears as usurping words and deploying them like weapons, using them to mask intent and to mean exactly the opposite of what they have traditionally meant, has been one of the most brilliant strategic victories of czars and the new dispensation. It has allowed them to marginalize their detractors, deprive them of a language to voice their critique. When the technique of sequestration fails to work, the dominant forces engage in more draconian measures, as was evident when a Tucson public schools official in Arizona banned Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed from classrooms because, according to a superintendent of the Arizona Department of Education, we should not be teaching kids that they're oppressed. In other words, conscientization, as a process to acquire the necessary critical thinking tools so that students, instead of internalizing their oppression, understand how institutions of power work to deny them equality of treatment, access, and justice, is not a goal of Tucson public schools, where courses that deal with issues such as race relations, ethics, and ideology are banned, and teachers are encouraged to promote a pedagogy of big lies through which students, in this case lower-class Mexican-American students, can be more easily domesticated. The almost total lack of public outcry in the United States regarding the censorship of books and the heisting of language that names reality in order to contest oppression may prove to be the keystone of our undoing. I'm amazed to witness academics engage in euphemisms as they aggressively object to any discourse that both fractures the dominant language and lays bare the veiled reality in order to name it. It is still more amazing to witness educators who claim to be Freirean fail to see the obvious impossibility of the oppressed apprehending through the process of conscientization a deepened consciousness of their situation as an historical reality susceptible of transformation, while these liberal educators remain complicit in the erasure of language, an act that empties out, for example, the meaning of the term oppressed. Many of these liberals eagerly embrace euphemisms such as disadvantaged, disenfranchised, economically marginal, minority, and at risk, among others, to refer to the oppressed, but in doing so, obfuscate the true historical conditions that explain the here and now, which constitutes the situation within which the oppressed are submerged, from which they emerge, and in which they intervene to denounce and confront their oppressors in the pursuit of full humanity. This sequestration of language denies people the possibility to understand the dialectical relationship between the oppressor and the oppressed. If you have an oppressed, you must have an oppressor. Thus, language is not only a site of contestation, it is also an indispensable tool for a critical reflexive demystification process that is central to conscientization, a process which Freire refuses to vulgarize and reduce to mere methods to be consumed by the so-called first-world progressive educators who, in many instances, remain chained to the mystification of methods and techniques and, indeed, a reduction of conscientization to certain methods and techniques used in Latin America for adult literacy. Hence, Freire's major goal, as I had mentioned earlier, was not to develop a literacy methodology to be used universally with oppressed people of the world. His main goal was to use literacy and the subsequent methods he developed for particular groups of adult learners to lead people to conscientization. In other words, no matter where we come from, all of us are involved in a permanent process of conscientization, as thinking beings in a dialectical relation with an objective reality upon which we act. What varies in time and space are the contents, methods, and objectives of conscientization. When human beings become aware and made themselves capable of revealing their active reality, knowing it and understanding what they know. Another critical misunderstanding of conscientization is to view the concept as a kind of tropical exoticism, a typically third-world entity. People speak of conscientization as an inviolable goal for complex societies, as though the third-world nations were not complex in their own way. This false dichotomy between the so-called first world and third world represents yet another sequestration of language designed to lead to a form of mystification, a distraction that functions as a reproductive mechanism designed to create a center or a core of romanticized Eurocentric values, while relegating other cultural expressions to the margins. The current attacks on Islam and on Muslims in general are a case in point, where Western media, political pundits, and academics often totalize religio-cultural extremists and generalize the extremism to all Muslims, framing them all as potential terrorists. At the same time, we conveniently ignore extremists of the West, like evangelist Pat Robertson, who camouflages his bigotry and his constant attacks on women. Take, for example, Robertson's statement that the feminist agenda is not about equal rights for women. It's about a socialist, anti-family political movement that encourages women to leave their husbands, kill their children, practice witchcraft, destroy capitalism, and become lesbians. If one substituted Robertson with a Taliban cleric and switched the words socialist and capitalism, the Western political class, the media, and other non-Muslim religious leaders would have a field day attacking the primitive nature of Islam and its radicalism while ignoring the diversity within the Muslim world that consists of billions of people from different cultures, classes, and ethnicities. Hence, institutional mechanisms in the West and in much of the world function by and large to contain and maintain these so-called primitive third world cultures that are often silenced by the incessant speech of the dominant culture so as to make these silent sections of cultures invisible or at least outside the parameters of public discussion or debate. Engaging Freire's conscientization process could help reveal the West's penchant for engaging in the construction of invisibility to keep the submerged cultures invisible and also to hide the West's own extremism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.